Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower, and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English. Coming up on the program, Brian Lin reports on a large 3D printer that can help with home construction. Andrew Smith has the health and lifestyle report on a study that found most Americans are not getting enough sleep. Then, John Russell has a few tips on how to sleep more. Later, Andrew and Jill Robbins present the lesson of the day. But first,
American researchers have developed a new model of what they say is the largest 3D printer in the world. The device is designed to build full-sized homes faster and for less money than traditional methods. A team at the University of Maine said the printer is 4 times larger than the last one the university built in 2019. That device was named the world's largest polymer 3D printer by the Guinness World Records organization. Developers of the new printer said it can create objects up to 29 meters long, 10 meters wide, and 5.5 meters high. The machine can use up to 227 kilograms of printing materials per hour. It was recently introduced to the public during an event at the university in the town of Orono. The latest model received new robotic abilities, additional sensors, and artificial intelligence AI technology, said Habib Doher. He leads the project for the University of Maine's Advanced Structures and Composite Center. Doher noted his team could build even larger printers in the future after the university opens a new building this summer. "We're learning from this to design the next one," he said. The old 3D printer was used in 2022 to build a 55-square-meter model home made from a mixture of wood fibers and a plant-based plastic material. The home, called Biohome 3D, was first printed in 4 parts before the pieces were moved to a permanent spot at the university. A team then connected the pieces and completed the building in just a few hours. Officials in Maine said such large 3D printers might be able to help the state meet a growing demand for housing. State housing officials have suggested Maine will need to build another 80,000 homes over the next 6 years to keep up with demand. The university aims to demonstrate that homes can be built almost completely with printers that do not harm the environment. The United Nations Environment Program estimates that building-related industries produce about 37% of greenhouse gases. The gases come from the production and use of materials, including cement, steel, and aluminum. 3D-printed buildings can also be recycled, which is unusual in the building industry. "You can basically deconstruct it," Doher said. "You can grind it up if you wish, the 3D printed parts, and reprint with them. Do it again." The team said it plans next to experiment with different printing materials. The researchers would like to use more wood found locally, since Maine is the most heavily forested state in the U.S. University of Maine Chancellor Danelle Malloy said the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers provided most of the money for the printer, which cost several million dollars. I'm Brian Lynn.
Less than half of Americans say they are getting enough sleep, according to a recent opinion study by the Gallup organization. The poll found that 57% of Americans say they would feel better if they could get more sleep. Only 42% say they are getting as much sleep as they need. Gallup carried out the same kind of study in 2013. That time, the results were different. 56% said they got enough sleep, while 43% said they did not get enough sleep. Women under the age of 50 were the most likely to report they are not getting enough rest. Only 27% of women in that group said they usually get all the sleep they need. The poll also asked people to report how many hours of sleep they usually get each night. Only 26% said they got 8 or more hours. Many sleep experts say adults should aim for 8 hours of sleep a night. Just over half of the respondents reported getting between 6 and 7 hours of sleep a night, and 20% said they got 5 hours or less. That number increased from 2013, when 14% of respondents reported getting 5 hours or less. Justine Bruegel is a self-employed event planner with 2 small children. She is 31 years old. Her 4-month-old son still wakes up throughout the night. After her 3-year-old daughter goes to bed, she still needs to do some work in the house. That makes it difficult for her to get the sleep she needs. I really treasure being able to spend time with my children, Bruegel says. However, she added that it can reduce the amount of time for her to rest and take care of herself. Claude Fisher is a professor of sociology at the University of California, Berkeley. He said that American culture has valued hard work and productivity since the first European immigrants arrived. He added that the religious beliefs of some groups connected hard work with approval from God. Working hard, he said, has been a core part of American culture for centuries. Some Americans also say their busy work days make them want to stay up late. After a long day of work, spending time at night on social media or watching television can help them lower stress or have some time to themselves. But this reduces the number of hours they can sleep. Liz Meschel has experienced this. the 30-year-old American is temporarily living and doing research in Bulgaria. But she also works a part-time job on U.S. hours to help pay her bills. That means she sometimes works until 10 at night local time. When it is close to her bedtime, she said she thinks about the time she did not have for herself during the day. So, she decides to watch television and look at social media instead of getting to sleep earlier. That, Meshel said, will always make the problem worse. I'm Andrew Smith.
Andrew Smith is with me now to talk more about today's health and lifestyle report. Hi, Andrew.
Thanks for having me, Dan.
Today's story was about an opinion study that found that more than half of Americans say they aren't getting enough sleep. There was one word in the story I was hoping you could explain, respondent. I feel like I only hear that word in connection to surveys.
That's true. The word respondent is only used in a very specific, technical way. It simply means someone who has answered questions to a survey. And just like the verb respond, the noun respondent relates to giving an answer.
Okay, let me ask you, Andrew. Are you getting enough sleep? How many hours of sleep do you usually get?
Recently, fortunately, I've been sleeping pretty well, and I get about 7 hours a night. But by Thursday and Friday, at the end of the work week, I feel pretty tired, and I do need more sleep. So on the weekend, I will try to get more than 7 hours. And what about you, Dan? How have you been sleeping?
Well, let's see. Last night, I had about 8 hours of sleep, which is pretty good for me. That might be because over the weekend, I was out pretty late and did not get much sleep. I guess for me, I have trouble with getting a consistent or stable sleep schedule. But I do like staying up late and waking up later, which is why I've come to like working from home. No need for the hour commute into the office.
I like working from home in many ways, but going to the office or someplace else to work also helps me move around, and it helps wake my brain up. And to be honest, some days I don't feel like my brain is really working very well until lunchtime or even in the afternoon. But getting some exercise always wakes me up.
And don't forget coffee.
Yes, that's what I tend to use on Thursday and Friday. It's coffee to the rescue.
Well, thanks for answering my questions, Andrew. Next, John Russell has a story on 5 ways to get more sleep. I'm interested in hearing what those are.
Do you spend too many nights trying to fall asleep? You are not alone. Nearly 1/3 of American adults say they do not get the suggested 7 to 9 hours of sleep a night. Nearly 1/3 of American adults say they do not get the suggested 7 to 9 hours of sleep a night. Some of the major causes are stress, anxiety, and a culture that experts say is about productivity, not rest. Molly Atwood of Johns Hopkins School of Medicine said, "You need to understand what your body needs and try your hardest to prioritize that and not just see sleep as kind of what's left over of the day. Sleep experts say that you should avoid unproven methods to fall asleep and stay asleep. Instead, they suggest 5 simple ideas. First, try creating a buffer zone, a time of separation between the end of your workday and your bedtime. Experts suggest leaving your work and daily responsibilities alone about an hour before bed. While in this buffer zone, you should not check email, pay bills, do housework, or look on social media. Instead, try to relax with a book, enjoy a fun activity, or spend time with loved ones. Dr. Anise Wilson of Baylor University said, "Anything that helps to center you and just helps you focus and release a lot of that tension from the day will then help promote sleep." Eating a large meal right before bedtime can also hurt your sleep. So try to eat in the early evening hours. Atwood said that eating a large meal is like giving your body a really large job to do right before sleep at a time when things are supposed to be shutting down. But do not go to bed very hungry either. Try small amounts of food with protein or healthy fats, like cheese, almonds, or peanut butter, on whole grain bread. Having an alcoholic drink or espresso after dinner could lead to a long night. While alcohol can help you fall asleep at first, it can also hurt your sleep cycle. As a result, the quality of sleep declines. The chances that you will wake up more often in the middle of the night increase. Caffeine blocks adenosine, a chemical that helps make you feel sleepy, and it can take your body up to 10 hours to clear caffeine. For these reasons, experts suggest finishing up your caffeinated or alcoholic drinks many hours before bed. Light from phones and computer screens can interfere with the circadian rhythm, or the internal clock that naturally wakes us up. Light has this effect by suppressing melatonin, which assists with sleep. But you will need self-control to stop looking at screens, suggested Dr. Diane Ajeli of Weill Cornell Medicine. TikTok doesn't want you to stop, Ajeli said. Only you can stop you, so you have to learn to put that stuff away. If you are still having a hard time getting a good night's sleep after more than 1 month of trying, experts say it is time to go to a doctor. This is especially true if your sleepless nights are hurting your work performance or your mood. Atwood said, "It doesn't matter how much relaxation you do. At a certain point, it's not going to be effective if there's a significant amount of stress. It might involve some problem solving to figure that out." I'm John Russell.
Is Anna Mateo.
My name is Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
You're listening to The Lesson of the Day on the Learning English Podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
We've been watching Anna learn about history in our last podcast, and she has been learning about the fun things to do in Washington, D.C. But in today's lesson, she finds that some days are not so fun. That's when she has to call into work, because she needs a sick day.
This time, in lesson 27 of the Let's Learn English series, Anna is not feeling well. Her boss, Ms. Weaver, gives her some advice. We'll be talking more about how we give advice in this lesson. But now, let's listen.
Hello. I'm sure that today, in Washington, D.C., there are a lot of great things to do. But I am not doing any of them. I'm sick. Right now, I'm going to call my boss and tell her I cannot come into work.
Hello.
Ms. Weaver? Hi. I can't come to work today.
Why not? What is wrong?
Well, yesterday I felt fine. In the morning, I painted for hours. In the afternoon, I cut wood. Then I built a fire.
Anna, what do you mean? Why can't you come to work today?
I do not feel well. I think I'm sick.
I'm sorry to hear that. I was sick last week, too. I had the flu.
What did you do?
I slept a lot, and I drank a lot of water. Do you have a doctor?
Yes, I do.
You should call your doctor and get lots of rest.
Thanks, Ms. Weaver. I'll call right now. Calling my doctor.
I think Anna just overdid it the day before, don't you, Andrew?
Yes, I do. To overdo means to have a little too much activity. For some of us, as we get older, we have to be careful. Using too many of our muscles at one time is one way to overdo it. And the next day, we may not feel well. What advice did Miss Weaver give to Anna, Jill?
She said Anna should call her doctor and get lots of rest. That's good advice when someone doesn't feel well. Let's find out what her doctor says.
Hello, this is Dr. Bennett. How can I help you?
Hello, Dr. Bennett. This is Anna.
Oh, hi, Anna. How can I help you?
I think I'm sick.
Let me ask you a couple of questions. Do you have a sore throat?
Yes, I have a sore throat.
Do you have a cough?
Yes, I have a cough.
When did you start feeling sick?
This morning.
In this part, we hear the doctor asking the usual questions. She is not giving advice yet, because first she has to diagnose or identify the problem Anna has. But I remember some advice I used to hear in my home growing up in the state of North Carolina when I had a sore throat.
Let me guess, was it honey and lemon? That's what my grandma used to make for me.
No, it was warm tea. My aunt made me some tea with a little lemon juice. I had to drink a lot. That's often helpful when you are feeling sick.
Yes, remember that Ms. Weaver said that when she was sick.
I slept a lot, and I drank a lot of water.
You know, when I was little, I liked eating popsicles, which is some sweet water or juice that is frozen on a stick when I had a sore throat. It felt great, and I think my mom knew it was a good way to get me to drink more water.
Yes, some of those home remedies often had a lot of wisdom behind them. One thing our listeners should note here is the different intonation we use for the two different kinds of questions we heard from Dr. Bennett. When she asked a question that began with when or how, her intonation was falling, like this.
How can I help you? When did you start feeling sick?
And when we ask questions that can be answered with yes or no, our intonation often goes up at the end, Listen to Ms. Weaver and Dr. Bennett ask this type of question.
Do you have a doctor?
Do you have a sore throat?
That could be useful for learners. The general rule is that what we call WH questions, questions that start with the words who, what, when, why, and how, those questions usually end with a falling intonation. You may sometimes hear a different intonation for this kind of question, depending on the situation. And then, yes-no questions. Those questions often begin with do or did, are or were. Those questions usually end with a rising intonation.
Let's go back and find out what Dr. Bennett tells Anna.
Do you have a fever?
Oh, my thermometer says 125 degrees. What?
Yeah, that's not right.
Oh, wait, the thermometer was in my hot cup of coffee.
Please, take it again, Anna.
Okay, the thermometer says 100.5 degrees.
100.5 degrees is not too high. I want you to drink lots of water.
Rest in bed and get lots of sleep.
Just think, all those years of medical school, and she gives Anna the same advice that you or I might give her.
And there's a funny bit in there about Anna putting her thermometer into a hot cup of coffee. Our listeners might be surprised to hear that a high temperature is over 100 degrees. But that's using the Fahrenheit scale. That would be over 38 degrees Celsius.
I remember hearing about international students who heard they had a 100-degree temperature here in the U.S., and they worried that they were really sick. But going back to our lesson, one more thing we heard here is irregular verbs.
That starts with Anna's busy day, when she said,
yesterday I felt fine. In the afternoon, I cut wood. Then I built a fire.
There, the present tense verb feel became felt in the past tense. Cut stayed the same, cut. The verb build changed to built in the past tense. And Ms. Weaver used an irregular verb when she said,
I slept a lot, and I drank a lot of water.
Sleep became slept, and drink became drank. Lots of irregular verbs.
I know, and how are learners supposed to remember them all? There are so many of them and so many different ways they change.
That's true. But some of them are used all the time in English, so that can make it easier to remember them. And you know what else could make it easier? We could make a little song about them. Music always helps us remember things.
Oh boy, that's a great idea, Andrew. How about if we just take the 10 most common irregular verbs and put them into a song?
Okay, here we go. Say, said.
Go, went.
Come, came.
Know, knew.
Give, gave.
Become, became.
Find, found.
Think, thought.
See, saw. I think that's all.
And that's all for today's lesson of the day.
And one more thing. Write to us with your questions about this lesson on our YouTube channel. Or email us at learningenglish@voanews.com.
You can learn more on our website, learningenglish.voanews.com. You can also find us on YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram. And thanks for listening to the Learning English Podcast. And I'm Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak.